Hello everyone, let's start with the next topic of computational learning theory. So the next topic is probably learning an approximately correct hypothesis. So in the basic part, we have studied that we have to find out how many training examples are enough to say that or to ensure that the learner will give you the successful hypothesis. Okay, and secondly, we have to also calculate the computational effort it requires, and third one, we have to calculate the mistake bound. So for that and further, we have to study about the probably learning an approximately correct hypothesis, whom we can call as PAC hypothesis. Now, what is this PAC learning model? So basically, we have to provide some learning settings to our learner, which we call it as probably approximately correct learning model. You can see in the notes also, I have mentioned it as we consider a particular setting for learning system. So particular setting is provided to the learning system, which we call as PAC learning model. So after specifying the PAC settings, then we have to focus on these questions, like how many training examples are enough for a learner and how much computations is required. Now, to understand which kind of setting is this which we have to provide the learning setting, I'm just taking an example. So there is a problem setting. Here I consider X as a set of all the instances. So as for example, I say the set of people, and these set of peoples are described by the number of attributes. Here I'm taking two attributes, one is age and one is height. Now I mentioned here C. C is the target concept that learner needs to learn. Now learner needs to learn the target concepts. Either it should be 0 or 1 in case of binary target class. So L is a learner, have to learn. What they have to learn? The system have to learn whether the people who are skiers. So we have to find out the people who are skiers and find out the people who are not skiers. So people who are skiers, for that the target concept is 1. So when the value of Cx equals to 1, all those instances are positive training examples. And for those training examples where the value of Cx is 0, they all are negative training examples. Now, while providing these PAC settings, we have to assume some of the things, like we have to assume that instances are generated randomly from X. X is a set of the instances, so we have to generate randomly according to some probability distribution. Now, this is a very important point. We have to decide the probability distribution D for the instance, and that probability distribution should be same for the whole process. Okay, so in general, D may be any distribution. The distribution which we have selected should be any distribution which is not known to the learner. Now, there is a very important point, which is D should be stationary. Now, it would not change over time. Now, let's say H. What is this H? H is a set of possible hypotheses. Now, H might be describable by the conjunction of the attributes. Like we are taking two attributes, age and height, and by the conjunction of these attributes, we can define our hypothesis. After get trained from training example, now L must output some hypothesis, which is its estimate of C. Now we know that whenever whenever our learner get trained by the training example, it will give us a hypothesis, and that hypothesis will generate an output. That output should be related to our target concept. So if there is a large difference between H and CX, we say that its performance is not good. If it is very approximate to 0 or it is equals to 0, we say that the learners having a very good performance. So now in the previous section, we have studied the PAC settings, and we have said that to evaluate the success of a learner, we have to check the performance. And how to evaluate the performance? We have to check the error of the hypothesis. So further, the next topic is error of the hypothesis. So for how to find out the error of the hypothesis? Every hypothesis give us the output in the form of the target value. So if the target value and H our hypotheses are same, that means the difference between them is zero. In that case, the performance is very good. And if the difference between them is very high, we say that its performance is not good. So here is the next term, which is very important, that is called true error. So we have to find out the true error of the hypothesis to evaluate the performance of a hypothesis. So what is this true error? This true error of hypothesis with respect to the target concept C and the distribution D is the probability that H will misclassify an instance drawn at random according to the D. Now I'll explain it. This true error said that what is the probability that it will misclassify the instance which we have drawn randomly. So we formulate it also, we have mentioned it as error H. True error is mentioned by error, sufficed by D, and H is said to be probability that CX is not equals to HX. Let's take an example of this diagram. Here, this is a instance space X, and I have drawn two circles. One circle specify the target class C and one circle specify the target class H. And the part where both C and H intersect, this is the part where we say that the hypothesis give the output which is equals to the C. So this is the output, we say that these are positive training examples, okay? And what are the negative training examples? Negative training examples are those training examples which are out of these C and H. These are negative training examples. So we have to, let's suppose we have to find out the positives one. We have to find out the value of target concept where its value is 1. So we have to find out that only. So the intersection part is the part where the training examples are positive, and where the part where both C and H, the target class and your hypothesis, disagrees. So this is the part where we say that the your training example misclassify. So if this particular area where C and H disagrees is very high, we said that the probability of misclassifying the training example which is drawn randomly is very high, or the true error is high. So basically this is the error of hypothesis with respect to our target concept class is the probability that the randomly drawn instance will fall into the region where H and C disagree. Important point that the true error which we have defined over the entire distribution of the instances rather than the training examples only. And we have already discussed it before also, that the probability distribution is unknown to the learner. We have to decide it by our own. And the other very important point is that it should be stationary, it should be overall same. So there is one more kind of error which we call it as training error. If we find out the error of the training examples, then we call it as a training error. Before that, we have discussed the true error. True error is the error over the entire distribution of the instances rather than the training examples only. So there is one more error which we call it as a training error. Training error is error corresponds to the training examples only. So we know that we have the training examples, and we can easily find out the error with respect to the training examples, or we also need to calculate the error over the entire distribution. So it is not directly possible, but indirectly it is possible, because L is a learner, can only observe the performance of hypothesis over the training example, but it cannot observe the instances which are drawn randomly. So up till now we have studied two kind of error. One is true error and one is your training error. So we have already discussed that the learner can find out the training error because it is dealing with the training examples, and true error, we have to estimate the true error with the help of the training error. But the question which arised over here is, how probable is it that the observed training error for H gives a misleading estimate of the true error DH? So if we have already found a training error, so what is the probability that our training error will give us the correct estimate of our true error, or it will mislead the computation of our true error? So here I discussed the difference between sample error and training error. Why I mentioned this sample error? Because sample error is also somewhat similar to the training error, because training error is dealing with training examples, and sample error also dealing with the sample examples only. So what is the main difference between two of them? The main difference between two of them is that the data drawn from S is independent of H. Means whatever the data we are drawing from the sample, or the instances we are drawn from the sample, they all are independent of H. But in case of training error, our H, our hypothesis, is very much dependent on our samples, training examples. Now let's see what is this PAG learnability. So we all know that our main aim is to find out the number of training examples which are required for a learner, which ensure that the learner is successfully learn the output, or the computation, or we can say that the amount of computation it requires, in which it ensures that it gives you the successful output. So basically we are here trying to find out the number of training examples which we need to learn a hypothesis H, for which find out when the system is going to learn the output completely or successfully. How we can evaluate it? We can evaluate it by finding out the error between hypothesis and the target class. So basically what we need to consider, a training error should be zero. This can only be possible either if we provide all the possible training example, possible instances, or if the training examples are drawn randomly, there will always have some non-zero probability that the training examples encountered by the learner will be misleading. So basically what it says that to find out the total number of training examples which are sufficient to ensure that the system learns successfully, for that we have to mention the true error should be zero. Now true error is only can give you zero in two cases. First case, when we have provided all kinds of possible training example to our learner, every instance, every attribute values, whatever the values can be, if we provide all the training examples, possible training example or instances to the system, then we can say that we can find out the true error can be zero, which can be an unrealistic assumption. Or secondly, if the training examples are drawn randomly, there will always be some non-zero probability. We cannot assure that whenever the training example which we are drawing randomly, it will always classify correctly. It might be possible that it will misclassify sometimes. So we cannot say that the probability is always zero. Sometimes we will get non-zero probability also. So what to do now? To resolve these two things, we have bound the error, or we cannot directly say that the true error should be zero. We can put some value, and we can allow the true error should be up to that particular number. If the true error is below or equal to that particular number, then it is accepted or acceptable. If the error or true error is greater than that particular value, we cannot accept that particular error. So what I told you, how to resolve these things? Firstly I mentioned the error should be bounded by some constant instead of zero. There we say that the true error should be zero, but we cannot define it as zero, because if we want a zero output, we have to provide that particular learner to all the possible training example or possible instances to the learner to give the zero output or to give the zero error. So it cannot be possible because it is a unrealistic assumption. So we say that just bound the error by some constant instead of zero. So we mention it by epsilon. It is considered very, very small value. So firstly, to find out the total number of training examples which are sufficient to ensure that the learner is successfully learn the problem, we mention that the true error is not equals, we are not going to mention true error which is equals to zero. We have to give that particular to a particular value. Also, we mentioned it as epsilon, and we are going to consider it a very small value. Now secondly, to find out the performance of the system, we always used to check the failure or the probability of failure or the number of time it fails, or we can say that the number of time the system misclassify the instance. So here we have to check how many mistakes the learner makes before it learn the problem completely. So we have to bound this number of mistakes also, how many mistakes the system can tolerate, and after how many mistakes we say that this much mistakes are not acceptable. So we bound the probability of failure also. So here we take a variable delta, which is used as a bound of failure, which is arbitrary, very small value. So in this way, we can make a learner that learns probably correct approximate of hypothesis. So basically what we are doing in PAC, we know that to define the number of total number of training example which is required by any learner to learn the problem successfully, we have to mention what error and bound. So basically error and failure. So if we bound these two things, we can estimate the total number of training examples required by it to successfully learn it. So error, true error, which we have mentioned here, we say that the true error should be bound by a small value, which is here known as epsilon. And secondly, the probability of failure is also bounded by some small value or arbitrary small value, which we call it as delta. Now let's see the proper or a standard definition of it. So here I have written down over there, consider a concept class C defined over a set of instances X of length N and a learner L using hypothesis space H. We can say that C is PAC learnable by L using H if for all target concept C which are belong to target class, distribution D over X number of instances epsilon such that epsilon will always lie between 0 and half. It is always greater than 0 and less than half. Similarly, where here we define delta such that the value of the delta lie between 0 and half. It should be greater than 0 and less than half. So here the learner L will with probability at least 1 minus delta. It means the probability of failure which it can tolerate, it should be 1 minus delta, then only it will output a hypothesis H which belongs to our hypothesis space H such that the error which it calculate it always less than or equals to epsilon in the time that is polynomial in 1 by epsilon, 1 by lambda, n and size C. So explain it properly. We know that there is a concept class which we need to learn with the help of the set of the instances X, and these set of instances, the length of the set of the instances are N. Now what is the length of the instances? Here they mentioned, they said that if a instance is a particular instance is described by the number of attributes. So let's say there are k number of attributes through which we described a instance X. So n is equals to k. So that total number of attributes through which we describe a instance X, with that particular k defined the length of the X. Now there is one more new thing which is called size C. What is this size C? Size basically we are considering the size of target concept. So it is the encoding length of सी एनकोडिंग लेंथ ऑफ टारगेट कॉन्सेप्ट और इन अ ईजी लैंग्वेज बेसिकली वॉट इज दिस साइज सी. साइज सी इज द नंबर ऑफ बूलियन फीचर्स एक्चुअली यूज टू डिस्क्राइब सी. सो हेयर एन एंड साइज सी इज बेसिकली यूज टू डिफाइन द इनहेरेंट कॉम्प्लेक्सिटी ऑफ द अंडरलाइंग इंस्टेंस स्पेस एक्स एंड द कॉन्सेप्ट क्लास सी. सो बेसिकली दीज टू आर द वेरिएबल्स विच आर बेसिकली यूज टू कंप्यूट द टोटल एफर्ट रिक्वायर्ड by a single instance or a set of instances. As we know that PAC is concerned with the total number of training examples required to learn the problem successfully. So if the learner requires some minimum processing time per training example, so if we know that what is the minimum processing time per training example, then for C to be PAC learnable or to learn C by using PAC learnable by learner, L must learn from a polynomial number of training examples. So polynomial number of training examples are given and it is going to learn the target concept through it. So we know the time required to learn it successfully. So if I know the time required by a single instance and the total time required to completely learn the problem successfully, then we can find out the total number of training examples required. Now let's take a look on the limitation of PAC learnability model. So basically PAC has one restrictive assumption in its definition that it consists the hypothesis in the hypothesis space which have the very small error or basically less than or equal to epsilon for every target concept C. Now it is very difficult to find if C is not known in advance. So in the previous section we know that the C is already given to us or to the system. If the C or the target concept is not known to the learner, how it will perform PAC learnability or how it will find out the total number of training examples required?